Next, we're moving over to floor planning, and we can look at floor planning under the floor plan view. So remember, we said that there are these three view buttons, and this one is called the floor plan view. Okay, so what do we have over here in this floor plan view? Well, we have our actual floor plan, which in this case has IOs around and it has standard cell rows inside. And this is what the actual floor plan is, and that's what we're going to basically see when we go over to the placement view. Okay, but we have the other two areas over here. On the right side, we have the hard macro. So in this macro over here, we have a bunch of SRAMs or other IP blocks, and they're going to be over here on the right side. At this point, they are not placed. They do not have a location inside the floor plan. So we can either grab them with something like the move button and put them inside the floor plan, or we can use all kinds of different commands that we'll see in the next video, the next lecture, not here, because we don't have actually any hard macros in this simple design that we're going over here. So we're going to go and we're going to place them inside the floor plan. On the other side, what we see is basically the modules. So if you have several different modules, hierarchical modules that appear with the size of the percentage of the area that is covered by the standard cells of them, and it can kind of give you a point of view if this is actually going to fit. So it kind of looks like if we put all these SRAMs in here and we have all this area for the standard cells, we're not going to be able to really fit very well inside the floor plan, but that's just a visual type of a thing. So at this point, we go over to actually making our floor plan, and that we do with the specify floor plan form or the create floor plan command. So we have everything inside this form that we can do, and you can play around with the options. But of course, we often just use a command that's inside one of our scripts, and the command is called create floor plan. And in the create floor plan command, there are lots of different options which are covered again in the form as well. So starting with what site is used, and match to site makes sure, you know, that it kind of changes the actual size that we had. So it's a multiple of the site, both height and width. So that can help us with different DRCs and stuff like that. Okay, and then we have this core density size, which is this big command that tells us what the aspect ratio is, which we would be setting over here, what the target utilization of the floor plan is, and that will set the size according to the estimated size of the standard cells after synthesis. So if we want a utilization of 70%, it will take the size and make it 30% larger. So that's with core utilization over here. And then these this foursum are the quarter boundary distances, which are actually set down here with these four buttons over here. So that's basically a create floor plan type of a command, and running this will actually resize our floor plan and give whatever we put over here. The floor plan size is something that we're either going to be given from a higher level that they're going to tell us what the floor plan size should be, or it's some sort of estimate that we should make according to a target utilization and the estimated size of our standard cells that come out of synthesis. So that basically finished our startup and setup stage, and now we're going to go to the floor planning stage. Okay, so what we have here now, as I showed you kind of before, is we have this, we're in the floor plan view, okay, and we're in this floor plan view. If we had more things, we would see them here. We would have different modules that the standard cell area would be shown here, and the RAMs and the different macros would be shown here, and we could go and drag them and put them in. And again, we'll see these types of things in a separate video. But for right now, what we're going to do is going to run a few commands that will set up our floor plan. And there is this floor plan menu here, and it has, for example, a form called specify floor plan. So in specify floor plan, I can select all kinds of things, like, for example, to make the core size according to an aspect ratio. Let's say I want the aspect ratio to be height over width of 0.7 or something like that. And the utilization of the core, let's say I want it to be 0.5 or something like that. Okay, I want to have core margins from the pins at the sides to the die boundary, so I can say what I want it on the left and the right. So like, just for the heck of it, let's do 2 and 4 and 6 and 8 just to see what it does. Okay, and I can do all kinds of other things over here. All right, and so I'm going to hit OK, and what that's going to do, it's going to resize my design, and according to these, edge or IO to core region, I got the different sizings over here. This looks a little bit weird, okay? This is a very, very small design. Again, we have only 47 standard cells in this toy example. It's really tiny. We also have the pins over here, so if I can, select one of these guys, and if I push Q, it will load my properties, and I can see that what I got is a port called clock, and there are actually more. I selected all of the ports over here, so I can see the different attributes of the different ports. Okay, and they're stuck at the 00 place because I didn't do anything to tell them to be somewhere else. Okay, so this is the floor plan. And again, what I can do now is I can look and see what the create floor plan command was. So it's written out actually over here. So it was create floor plan with the site of my standard cell library, what the size, the core density and size were. So this was 0.7 was the ratio, 0.5 was the utilization, and these were the distances to the left, right, top, bottom boundaries, something like that. So actually what I have done is I've already copied these things into a script file, and the script file is under inputs because this is something we're going to change for our specific design, and it's called sm.floorplan_defines. And we see that there is a command here, or a variable, floor plan ratio, floor plan utilization, floor plan space to core, and I just set these things up. And I've defined a whole bunch of other types of things over here that we're going to look at in a little bit. Okay, and these were actually run by sourcing the sm floor plan defines command. So let's go back to Innovus.tickle, and we see, so what I did is I sourced this floor plan defines command. Okay, and then I can create the floor plan. There are many ways, again, many options in the create floor plan command. Just for example, let's look at the man pages of this. So create floor plan, and we see that there are actually quite a few options, and you can read through and see what they do and so forth. But again, I set it up here. So we have create floor plan minus the site of the standard cell library, core density size with that four, those four figures that were over here. Okay, so I run this create floor plan command, and right after it, I have a GUI fit, so it will resize my window to actually fit inside there. So I'm going to run this, and now going back to my floor plan, I see that I have the floor plan that I set up, which is the standard cell size with, it took the actual area that was of the standard cells, multiplied it by the ratio, which I think I set 0.75 over there, and that is set the size, the area of this square, of this rectangle. The ratio is what I set, which was like 0.7, so that's why it's rectangular in this way and not square, something like that. And the distance between the IO and the core is what I set over there, and we can select the ruler. Where's the ruler? The ruler is over here, or we could just press K, and I can measure how much I set up, and it's about 5, right? That's the ruler. Okay, so what I asked for is 5 on each side, and we can see that we have the rulers. Usually Shift K will erase all the rulers, and then you click on this guy, and it brings us back our regular arrow. So what about pin location? In the placement lecture, we saw that the pin locations, or the port locations, they have a very significant effect on the analytic placement solution. But where do these locations actually come from? And it's a really bad answer that I have to give you, because when you run this type of flow, you'll see that by default, Innovus just sticks them in the corner. And I've seen many a student not actually move these, and then all of our pins actually start out of the corner, and that's going to make a complete and total mess. So we could have 1,000 pins that are stacked one on top of the other over here. So we have to actually locate them, and this location has a profound effect on the solution of our placement in the end. But there's often not well-defined methodologies of where and how to place these things. So it's something that you should take into consideration. Here I'm just going to show you really how we're going to do this how we're going to move them, but I'm not going to explain to you how to do it logically. That I kind of explained in the lecture. Okay, so there are several ways to locate the pins. One of them is to manually move them. Go and grab each pin and move it to some location somewhere around the boundary. And that is a possibility. Another one is to use the pin editor. And the pin editor is this kind of, you can see it's a pretty complex form, but it allows us to do all kinds of things that we're going to move the pins around, and you can play with this. But this is actually done with this pretty big command, which is called edit pin. And here are two examples of how to use the edit pin command. This is to take one single pin and put it somewhere. So I hit pin minus pin clock. That's going to move the clock pin. It's going to say it's a clock pin. It's going to put it at this coordinate, 0 by 3.9. Fix overlap. In case I put two pins on top of each other, they'll move them so they don't overlap with each other. It's going to say which side is it going to be on. It's at the top side of the macro. Using layer 3, so I guess that's metal 3. This could be metal 2 in some cases, but the third layer, whatever that is defined in our technology. What the width and depth, so the size of the actual pin, because in this case it's just a piece of metal. So it's going to be a piece of metal 3 that's going to be 100 by 100 nanometers wide. Okay, wide and height. So that's one way to do it and assign each and every single pin with a similar command. But a kind of way to start with these things is use a basic command that goes and spreads all the pins. So I can do something like edit pin and give it a list of all these pins that I want to spread. Where do I want to spread them? On a side, which side? On the bottom side. I want to use layer 2 over here. And which direction I want to spread them? In a clockwise direction, so I'm going to spread them on the bottom from the right to the left in this case. And it wants to fix the overlaps in case one of the pins overlaps with another. So that's kind of a basic way to spread all the pins. There are many more functions for doing this because it really is an important thing. So pin groups and all kinds of things like that, they usually come with the hierarchical flow, which I do not go over in this course. So at this point in our flow, we're at the point where we have to get the pins, which are right now down here in the bottom left corner, and spread them around the floor plan. Now, as I mentioned in the different lectures, the best way to do this is actually in a top-down hierarchical flow, where if I'm designing a macro, whoever's doing the top level will actually set the different sub-blocks around the top level and then assign the pins to a certain place so they'll be kind of coordinated with the top level and with the other sub-blocks. But if I'm doing it bottom-up, what I'm going to do is I'm going to want to put the pins in certain places, and this is a very critical and important stage, which unfortunately sometimes we don't have any good way of doing it, and so we would just kind of spread them. There are quite a few options of doing this in the UI. So you can see here that there's this edit pin group, edit pin guide, and pin editor. The pin editor is kind of the main one. It has lots and lots of options of how I'm going to take these different pins and assign them in different metal layers and on different sides of the floor plan and so forth, and how I'm going to put them and so forth. So you can really play around with these types of things. Again, there's also the edit pin group to make groups of pins and edit pin guide, and all of these things will translate in the end to some commands. So just to start, what I have here is this edit pin command. So I made a collection of pins to spread. So with this set pins to spread, getdbports.name, collected all of the names of all of the ports in my design. So we have this edit pin command, which is, I'm just going to right now just spread the things around. There are lots and lots of options with this edit pin command. It's a very large command that covers those different forms that I showed you a second ago. So what I'm just going to do is edit pin minus spread type start. So it's going to start at 0, 0. That's the bottom left coordinate, and spread clockwise around the floor plan. So we're going to spread the pins like this. It's going to use M3 for the horizontal pins and M4 for the vertical pins. The pins that it's going to spread are the ones that we grabbed over here, and just fix overlaps and have a certain spacing factor. So this is really generic. This is not the correct way to do it. You have to have some idea of where you want to put the pins. Some of it will be fed back from after we do the floor planning and we see how, after we do the placement and see how different areas are going to be placed, we may want to have some sort of, we may have some sort of guidelines that we build to how to spread the pins and so forth. So there can be thousands of pins on a certain sub block. So this is really critical and it's going to very much affect the placement. So let's just run this right now. So it says it successfully spread 9 pins. And now let's go back and see what this did. So I'm going to refresh. I can do Control R, and it refreshed the view here. And we see now that we have in the corner over here, we have the pin, which is pressing Q. That is clock, right? And over here,
we can zoom in on these types of things. It's reset n, and you can see that it's a piece of what layer is this? It's over here, I guess, metal 4. We can remove the layers and then light up metal 4 over here, and we see that that's what this little piece of metal is. This is the virtual kind of pin that we have that adheres to the design browser. If we go into terms, right, so that would be reset n. Say we wanted to go to the overflow pin, we could go and we could zoom to select it over here, and it will show me the overflow pin. And we don't see the piece of metal because we turned it off, so that was going to be on metal 3. So I turned on metal 3 now, and we can see this metal 3 pin over here. It says overflow on it. So we get all of the pins now spread around in this way. Probably not a good idea to put our clock so far away here in the corner. Again, I just use some sort of a random pin spreading. When you have your real macro, which is going to be much bigger, and you see where things are, so forth, you have to really think about where each and every one of these pins should be if you don't get it allocated from a top level design where you know they align buses and so forth. So this GUI redraw command that I had here would do the same as I pressed Control R. It just redraws the GUI. As I said, every single GUI operation I do has a command line equivalent that can run it. So if we go over here back to the terminal, you see that when I just select the different points, it actually printed out on the screen. So I can take those things and use them, set layer preference, you know, if I wanted to make a layer visible or not visible. These things I can actually go and put in my script to automate them.